Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we're so grateful tonight we can come together and celebrate your goodness, Lord. Tonight is not about a man or a woman, not about the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine, God. It's about you. We celebrate your faithfulness, God. We just rejoice in your house tonight, looking at what you can do with broken lives, God, that our tests and our trials become our testimonies in the message of the glory of God. Tonight, Lord, as we open up your word, we pray that you open us up to receive. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Lord, we thank you that tonight the Holy Spirit is our teacher and our guide. Come, Holy Spirit, be welcome in this place. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, the correction that we need for our lives, Lord, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, God, that are hearing and preaching the gospel. We bless them as you would bless us, God. Also, we remember our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad the world. Lord, we ask that you strengthen them, encourage them, deliver them, bless them. May they never give up, Lord. May they endure to the end. Father, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. You can have a seat. Get your Bibles out tonight. If you're looking to turn somewhere, you can follow along. We're going to be using some different translations tonight. As I was looking at the message tonight, I just like the way that it said it in some different translations. But if you want to read along, Romans chapter 2, you can go there with me. And I got to make a qualifying statement before I go into this message, okay? Just so that you don't start looking for the nearest exit or start rolling your eyes or wondering why you came to church tonight. All right, I did not have a bug in your car. I was not at your house. No one was listening in on your conversations before you came to church, okay? So let's just clear that out of the way. I've had this message prepared for weeks. All right, I knew exactly what I was going to preach on when I came back from vacation because I knew I was on the Wednesday I came back. And so this is in no way reflective of what you've gone through today. Tonight's message is about resolving conflict. All right, everybody say this. Say 3, 2, 1. 3, 2, 1. Okay, now say 3, 2, 1, conflict. 3, 2, 1. It can happen that fast, right? Somebody says something dumb. And all of a sudden, you're hot. You could crack an egg and fry it on your head. You're so mad, right? Spitting, angry, just angry about what they said. Why were they so dumb? They're wrong. Don't they know what they did? They're just fools, right? Now, you can tell a person who's full of themselves by how many times they say I, right? I this, I that, you know, the unholy trinity, me, myself, and I. But you can tell someone who is not open to their faults when you hear them say they. And so tonight, if we're going to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, we got to understand how is the godly way to resolve conflict, because it's going to happen. You're going to disagree. You're going to have arguments. There's going to be fights. There's going to be things that take place. You're not going to get along with everyone. Can we just say, you know, that's okay? All right? Is it all right to tell the truth in church? See, because sometimes we think when you get saved, you got to kind of check your brains at the door. And I'm going to just leave that there. And when I come into church, everything's happy. Everything's wonderful. Oh, my marriage. Yeah. Oh, brother, my marriage is doing great. Thank you for asking. We're just so in love. When you know on the way to church, you were yelling at your wife, screaming at the kids, you had one hand on the wheel and one hand back trying to slap something, right? You didn't care who or what it was, you just wanted to get something. Okay? If we get locked in conflict, it can be fatal to our relationships. See, consider the bull moose. I'll put a picture up for you up on the overheads. During mating season, oftentimes they lock horns. These two bull moose locked horns and actually died because they could not separate. See, an unresolved conflict is a lot like that. You are locked in a struggle with somebody, and if you stay that way, the relationship will end up dead, just like those two moose up there on the overheads. Are you listening tonight? See, we need to be responsible for our own actions. Thank you, guys. You can take the picture of the dead animals off. There you go. That's much better. Much better. All right. We can't make choices for other people, but we can make choices for ourselves. We've got to own our own actions. And it's simple. Can I tell you this? It's simple. It's so easy. It's easy as 3-2-1 conflict. That's why I had you say that tonight, is because my points tonight, I'm not going to give you a 1-2-3. I'm going to give you a 3-2-1. Is that okay? All right. And I'm going to give them to you in the order of importance. Okay. So if we're going to resolve conflict, three quick ways to resolve conflict with a 3-2-1. Number three is this: stop pointing the finger at others. If we're going to resolve conflict, we got to stop pointing fingers at other people. They. See, you may have heard the statement, you know, if you point one finger at someone else, you got four pointing back at you, right? You ever heard that? That's not true. Only three fingers are pointing back at you. The thumb is just doing its own thing out there, all right? See, sometimes it's pointing up at God, sometimes it's pointing off in random distances. You don't even know where it's going, okay? So, but there are three. That's why number three is stop pointing the finger at yourself. Now you're going to remember it, right? Because there are three fingers pointing back at you. So stop pointing the finger. When you point the finger at someone else, you are just going over and not taking responsibility for what you did. And yet God says you're not responsible for someone else's actions. You're not responsible for someone else's words. When you go before the judgment seat, when everything's all wrapped up, when it's all said and done, whether they lower you into the ground here on the earth and you appear spiritually before the Lord, or whether he comes and you're caught up in the air with him, one way or another, you're going to go before the Lord and you are going to answer for your actions. And when God says, why did you break out the high school words on your spouse? Are you going to say, well, they made me do that? God, you don't understand. I wouldn't have yet said those words if they hadn't have made me angry. And God will say, oh, yeah, you're right. Yeah, no, no, it's just fine. I understand. I would have said some high school words too. No, it's not what God would have done. God's going to say, I don't care what they did. I know what they did. And I'll talk to them about what they did. But right now, I'm talking to you about you. God's starting to sound like Father. That's because he is, right? That's how my daddy talked to me. See, we need to get a hold of this picture. We need to understand that we have to own our own actions. If we're going to resolve conflict, I can't be responsible for the other person, but I can be responsible for me. Come on, somebody. Can you say amen to that tonight? It's good news. It's not bad news. It's the good news, because we're resolving conflicts. See, what are you responsible for in the conflict? What are you doing? Did you shout? Did you raise your voice? Did you get physical? What are you doing? What are you responsible for? Can you make a change that will help to resolve the issue? Can you change your tone? This one's for the men, right? Because the men will say something, and all of a sudden conflict breaks out. It elevates. You're in a shouting match. You're sleeping on the couch, and you're wondering what happened. Next day, you wake up, and you say, what happened yesterday? They say, well, you had a tone. You're laughing because it's happened to you, right? But see, can you change your tone? Can you be more aware of the way that you talk? Maybe you're one of those people that just, your face, when you start thinking about something, you get angry eyebrows. And everybody's going, why are they angry? Right? You're on the job. You're thinking about something. You're trying to work out a problem. And there you are. And somebody walks in and says, hey, I need some help on this job. And you say, can you give me a minute? Right? And you got the angry eyebrows. And they're going, whoa, okay, I see what's going on. All of a sudden, there's conflict. Why? Because you were thinking. What can you change? Can you be more aware? Are you lording over somebody? You know, are you pushing your way? Are you being selfish? Hello? What are you responsible for? You're responsible for you. You can't be responsible for someone else. But what can you change that will help resolve the issue? Pointing the finger will only hurt. It won't help. It's only going to hurt. It's only going to make the conflict go on longer, and you will stay locked like those two moose. Romans chapter 2, if you're there, you can read along, but I'm going to read it in the Message, okay? I have this up on the overheads. I just love the language that Eugene Peterson used when he wrote this. This is a paraphrase, okay? So this is not a direct translation. This is him thinking about this, and he was thinking about this. How could I have the Bible so that my children would understand it? So he wrote the Message paraphrase, and now it's for all of us to get a better understanding what the Word of God has to say to us. And I love the way he said this. Romans chapter 2, verse 1 through 4 says this. It says, those people that are on a dark spiritual downward, okay, he's talking about people that are without God, okay? Now, it'd be easy for us in the church to judge people who are outside, but look at what he says. But if you think that leaves you on the high ground where you can point your finger at others, think again. Every time you criticize someone, you condemn yourself. It takes one to know one. Hello. Judgmental criticism of others is a well-known way of escaping detection in your own crimes and misdemeanors. Wow. But God isn't so easily diverted. He sees right through all such smoke screens and holds you to what you've done. You didn't think, did you, that just by pointing your finger at others, you would distract God from seeing all your misdoings and from coming down on you hard? Or did you think that because he's such a nice God, he'd let you off the hook? Better think this one through from the beginning. I love this. God is kind, but he's not soft. Hello. That should be on a t-shirt or something, right? I need that on my coffee mug when I wake up in the morning. God is kind, but he's not soft. I don't have no wimpy Jesus. That man endured the scorn and the suffering of the cross. God is no wimp. God is not a pushover. God is kind, but he's not soft. He is a loving father who disciplines us. Look at this. In kindness, he takes us firmly by the hand and leads us into a radical life change. Man, that's what I'm talking about tonight. I don't want to do conflict the way the world does conflict. I don't want all the, you know, psycho, all that kind of stuff going on. I want to find out, what does the Word of God have to say about my life? And then I want to do things God's way so I can get God's results. And I know that's what you want. That's why you're here tonight. See, sometimes finger pointing isn't just at the time of the event. It's after the event, right? We have a tendency to hold things over people's heads. We can nag on things, or we say we forgave, but then when next time something happens, oh, this is just like last time. I knew you were going to do this again. Man, I forgave you, and look at what you did. See, and we lord things over people's heads, and yet look at what the Word of God has to say in Proverbs chapter 17, verse number 9. Again, different translation. I like the way it said this for our understanding tonight. Proverbs chapter 17, verse 9. I'll put it up on the overheads. Whoever forgives an offense seeks love, but whoever keeps bringing up the issue separates the closest of friends. See, marriage is the closest bond. It's a covenant where two people come together as one. And not only in marriage, but our close relationships, our friendships, our partnerships with business and different things that we do in life, even our neighbors. If we continually point the finger, you did this, I remember when, this is just like last time. If we continually bring those things up, we're going to end up separating the closest of friends. This will tear down marriages. This will break down the best of friendships. This will destroy years of friendships if we continue to point the finger. So, three quick ways to resolve conflict with 3, 2, 1. Number three, stop pointing the finger at others. Second thing is this. Number two is to believe the best. Now, once again, I've got a little way for you to remember this. Up on the overheads, believe the best. There's two B's in that. So number two, two B's, all right? Believe the best. See, when we choose to believe the best, the future is brighter. But if you choose to believe the worst, there's going to be a dark cloud hanging over your future. And often when we deal with forgiveness and conflict resolution, people don't know how to move forward. They don't want to get hurt again, so they close off their heart and they don't allow people back in, right? It's like, you hurt me, and now you don't have access to this anymore. Now, I understand trust takes time, okay? So when we talk about forgiveness and trust, those are actually two separate issues, right? Okay, because there has to be a track record, there has to be time, there has to be healing that takes place, okay? So when we talk about trust, that's one thing. I'm talking about forgiveness over here, okay? So we get hurt. What do we say? We say, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. You're not getting back here ever again. The door is locked and it's closed, and I'm never opening it up to you again because I don't want to get hurt. That's the response to many people. And yet when I read in the Bible, I find out that Jesus washed the feet of the disciple who he knew was going to betray him. Jesus wrapped himself in a towel, knelt down as the master, and served the one who was going to betray him, knowing that it would lead to a painful beating, trial, and eventually his execution, his death. So if Jesus would open himself up to be vulnerable and allow himself to be led into pain and sorrow and suffering, what am I doing not opening myself up to pain again? See, we need to allow ourselves to forgive and then to start believing the best. You say, but Pastor, what if I get hurt? Then you'll survive. Then you get hurt. And then you forgive. Now again, trust is a separate issue. Okay? And let me say this. What I am not telling you to do, everybody got this? This is what I'm not telling you. Okay, so don't leave this place. Pastor Dan said, no, I did not. Everybody got it? Everybody say not. Okay, I'll put a not in your head. No, I'm just kidding. I did not say put yourself in harm's way. I did not say put yourself in compromise to sin. Okay, are we understanding each other now? Are we hearing this? Okay, I did not say to put yourself in those predicaments. But what I am saying is if it's healthy, if it's not sinful, and if you're building trust, then open yourself up again to be hurt. It's okay to be vulnerable. It's okay to be tender and to open yourself up again to love and to forgive. Why? Because when we love, now we start looking like God. Because Jesus Christ died for us while we were still sinners. Opened himself up to hurt. He knew we would sin. Even after we got saved. Anybody sinned after they got saved? Anybody brave enough with Pastor Dan to raise their hand and say, I sinned after I got saved? Right? We all have. We all have. Everybody. The Bible says if you say you're without sin, you're a liar. So we all have. God knew that we were going to sin even after we got saved, and yet he still went to the cross, he still loved us, and he still allowed himself that vulnerability. And so what are we doing when we say, I'm not going to forgive, I'm just going to close it up? No, you got to believe the best. Look at what love does. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, turn there with me. This time I'll read in the New King James Version. Most of the time we preach and teach out of the New King James Version. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 talks all about love, okay? The whole chapter is all about love. Starts to describe that love is patient, kind, long-suffering, okay? Now drop down to verse number 7 of 1 Corinthians chapter number 13 and take a look at what it says. Love bears all things. In other words, love loads its back up with whatever life is going to bring it, including pain, including trouble, including sorrow. Love can bear it. Look at this. Love believes all things. In other words, love says, you know what? God's not finished with them yet. Love says, I used to be like that. And you know what? I'm not going to let this conflict continue. I'm going to be the bigger person and say I'm sorry, even though I'm right. Hello? Love says, I'm going to build a bridge, not build a fire. Come on, somebody. Love believes all things. Love says, we can work this out. Love says, this is not how it's going to be forever. Love says, we're just working on this right now, and we're going to find what the Holy Spirit has to say about this, and we're not going to let this thing stay. Love says, the devil will no longer wreak havoc in our relationship. We're stopping this right now, and we're going to take care of business. That's what love does. Love believes the best. Love looks to the future with hope and says, this doesn't have to be the way it is. Look at this. Hopes all things and endures all things. Love outlasts the problem and the trial and the pain. That's what love does. That's what love does, and that's what we do. It's as easy as 3, 2, 1. Three quick ways to resolve conflict with 3, 2, 1. Number 3, stop pointing fingers at others. Number 2, believe the best. And finally, how about this? Number 1, walk in love. Now, how do you remember this one? One love, right? I won't even sing the song for you. But one love. Number 1, walk in love. We've been talking about love already. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse number 8. Turn there with me in your Bible. It's good to find out where these scriptures are. Mark it in your Bible. Highlight it. Underline it. Circle it. Put a star next to it. Put a dog ear on the page. Whatever you have to do to get back to this. Maybe you want to write it on your notes or in the back of your Bible so that you can get back to it. Walk in love. Now, why would we say this and emphasize this so much in conflict? Here's why. Take a look. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse number 8. And above all things. Everybody say, above all things. That means this is top priority. This is number one. Above all things, above not finger pointing, and above believing the best, above all things, have fervent love for one another. Not just love for one another, fervent love. Fervent love says, I love you so much that I don't even care if you're shouting in my face right now. I still love you. Fervent love says, I love you so much, and even though you're so wrong, we're going to work this out. We're still going to be good on the other side of this. Fervent love says, I love you too much to leave you alone. I'm going to bug you until we resolve this. I've had many nights with my wife because I have a fervent love for her where I pestered her and would not let her go to sleep. Even though she said, honey, all I need to do is sleep. We can work this out in the morning. I said, no. And I poke her in the side to wake her up, even though she's going to slap my hand. Why? Because I love her too much to let the sun go down on our wrath. I love her so much that I don't want to leave conflict unresolved. See, love says, I love you so much. I love you passionately. I love you enough to tell you the truth, but I also love you enough to yield my rights and my way so that we can resolve this and walk in a spirit of unity, oneness, and agreement the way Jesus wants us to. Whether you're married in this place, whether it's just a Christian brother or sister, where maybe it's with someone on the outside. You know, you've been kind of butting heads with them, and you need to humble yourself and say, listen, as a Christian, I have not been a good witness, and I have been in conflict with you. I've beaten you over the head with the Bible. I've done everything except share with you the love of Jesus. I'm sorry. I'm wrong. Let's end this. See, fervent love says, I love you too much to let you go to hell. Fervent love. Fervent, passionate, on fire love. Above all things, have fervent love for one another. For love will cover a multitude of sins. But pastor, you don't know what they did. Love covers. Pastor, you don't know the hurt. Love covers. You don't know how wrong they were. I mean, they're just way out there, like on the moon. Love covers. See, love will cover the multitude of sins. See, you can't forgive unless you forgive through the power of love. You have to forgive in love, and then you can move forward. Love is the most powerful force in the universe because the Bible says in 1 John chapter 4 that God is love. Now, there's nothing more powerful than God. Therefore, when we operate in love, we are now operating in the supreme power of the universe. So that's why we're told to walk in love. Because love covers the multitude of sin. God covers the multitude of sin. God will take care of it. God will make everything right in the end. God, vengeance is his, says the Lord. You don't have to worry about it. Even if they never repent, never say sorry, never ask for your forgiveness, never come off of it, you can let them stay there and die, but you're not going to stay there and die. You're going to go on with God, and God will settle accounts at the end of it all. When we operate in love, it will work out better than when we operate in offenses. Let me say that again. When we operate in love, it will work out better than when we operate in offenses. Last verse for today, Proverbs chapter 10, verse number 12. It's actually where the Apostle Peter was quoting from in 1 Peter 4:8. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 12. Hatred stirs up strife. You want to lock horns and stay there? You're being fueled by hate. Hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all sins. It's as easy as 3, 2, 1. Number three, you guys remember? Come on, I just preached the message to you guys. Okay, open your Bibles to Romans chapter 2. Okay, let's get it together. You guys got it, okay? What was number three? Well, number two, and what was number one? I think you got it tonight. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise for the word of God tonight. Immediately applicable. Go get in the car with your wife and kids and say, I'm sorry. God is good. Hey, I want to talk to you guys before you leave this place. A couple of you guys got up and you're out there in the foyer and the bathrooms down the breezeways. I've got speakers in all of those areas, so just listen up right where you're at. God wants to talk to you wherever you're at right now, listen up. Give me a couple more minutes of your time, then I'll let you go. We'll talk to you guys about your eternal life. You know, we talked about going before God when it's all said and done. And everybody's going to get to stand before God when this life is all wrapped up. Whether we die or whether Jesus comes back one way or another, we're all going to have to stand before God on our own and give an account of what we did while we were in the body. Now, everyone gets to go before God, but not everyone gets to stay before God. There will come a time where our works are judged. It will be either judged based on what we've done in the flesh or what Jesus did while he was in the flesh. You can either depend on yourself or you can depend on him. What do I mean by that? Well, let me present it to you like this in the form of a question. What makes you think you're going to get to stay? What makes you think you're going to get to go to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, I'm going to get to go to heaven because, you know, I've been a really good person. God lets good people into heaven, right? You know, I haven't done a lot of bad stuff in my life. Yeah, I used to be bad, but, you know, clean up my act. Now I'm good. I'm going to get to stay. I'm going to get to go to heaven, be with God forever because I've been good. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say, just be good and you get to go to heaven? It doesn't work like that. There's no grading scale in the back of the Bible, no line, no curve that you have to be above. Just be this good and God will let you into heaven. It doesn't work like that. In fact, the Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Not going to make it based on your goodness or your own merit. The Bible tells us that our goodness compared to God's goodness is like filthy rags. Going to get to thrown out. Not going to get to stay. Be burned up. Now, sometimes people hear that and say, Pastor, are you talking about hell? Yeah, because you're only going to go one of two places. You're either going to get to stay with God and go to heaven forever and ever, be with Jesus forever, or you'll have to leave the presence of God. And he will say, away from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. And you'll be cast out of his presence, the Bible says, into the lake of fire, where there's eternal punishment and torment. Now, sometimes people say, well, I don't believe in hell. That's a very terrible thought to me. And, you know, I think that parents just made that up to scare their kids into being good. Be good or you'll go to hell. And yet I find it in the Bible. It talks about it in the Old Testament, the New Testament. Jesus talked about it. It's a very real place. Now, if you were walking in the street and I saw a car coming at you, I wouldn't say, hey, you should probably get out of the street because it's a good idea. No, I'd say, hey, get out of the street. There's a car coming. And I'd tell you the truth. And yet, when preachers start talking about hell, people start saying, well, why are they yelling at me? Why are they saying this? Here's why. Because there's something coming at you that you need to look out for. And I want to make sure that you go to heaven and that you don't go to hell. You want to make sure that you go to heaven and don't go to hell. But listen, God himself wants to make sure that you go to heaven and don't go to hell. That's why he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross. Sometimes people say, well, don't all roads lead to heaven, Pastor? I mean, you do your thing, I'll do my thing. The church is out there, they can do whatever they want. You know, God sees that and appreciates that. He's opened the way. It's wide, it's open. Everybody can go now. And just stay true to yourself, do your thing, and we'll all make it to whatever it's actually called out there, whether it's heaven for you or, you know, nirvana for someone else. We'll all make it there somehow. All roads lead to heaven. The problem with that thinking, let's apply that to the earth for a second. What if I told you all roads lead to the moon? You'd say, you're crazy. You're nuts. Not all roads lead to the moon. Doesn't matter how long you drive around the earth, you'll never make it. Well, then what makes us think that all roads lead to heaven? What makes us think do whatever you want to do and you'll just get there? See, the Bible doesn't say the way is wide and open and all that kind of stuff. It says the way is open, but it says it's narrow and there are few who find it. It's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. Can't get there your way. Can't get there my way. Can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. Going to have to get there God's way. And don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, don't you think after he does all that on the cross that he would let us know how to get to heaven? Well, he does right here in his word. Now, sometimes people say, well, that's good news, Pastor, because I was raised in church. Parents told me we're Christians growing up. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. You went to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, wore religious jewelry, cross, St. Christopher, you know, something like that, T-shirt that said Jesus, you know. Maybe you had a bumper sticker on your car that had a scripture verse on it. And you've always considered yourself to be a Christian. Born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhists, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians, right? Wrong. Do you know that nowhere, check it out, nowhere in the Bible does it say, because you're raised in church, your parents tell you you're a Christian, that you're a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, be baptized or christened as a child, that you get to go to heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're born in America, that America is a Christian nation. And everybody born in America gets to go to heaven. And I don't see anywhere in the Bible, check it out, there's nowhere in the Bible that says, because you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Come on, let's talk about your eternal life. What makes you think you're going to get to stay, go to heaven, be with God forever and ever? Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, you don't understand. Not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church in front of you right now. And I consider myself to be a Christian. Well, that's great, and I'm glad you're here tonight. You know that nowhere in the Bible does it say, you sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. That's like me saying, you know, I've decided to become a fish. And so I go down to the Pacific Ocean, sit in the water, and call myself a fish. Doesn't matter how long I sit there, you know what's going to happen? I'm going to become a pruny human being, wet and slimy. But I will never become a fish just because I sit in the water and call myself a fish. Same way, you can't just sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Abracadabra, here I am. Doesn't work like that. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, okay, I get that. I understand that. But you don't understand. My last church, I got involved. I helped out. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I even got a membership card to that church, taught the Bible classes. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible. Where God's looking for your volunteerism, looking for you to do something in church, sing in the choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. You get to go to heaven. It doesn't work like that. And guess what? Nowhere in the Bible, check it out, nowhere, is God waiting at the gates of heaven looking for your membership card to a church. If that's how you think you're going to get to go to heaven, you're not going to make it. You say, Pastor, okay, I understand all that. Someone told me, though, that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate the resurrection at Easter. Sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor, Old and New Testament. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, if you'd read your Bible, you know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. If you read your Bible, you know the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth. And yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here for me. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. But rather, this is about your heart. Jesus said it like this. He said, unless you're born again, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. See, you can't get there any other way except God's way. And Jesus said that statement, John, the third chapter, you must be born again. It's that simple. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They've raked it to the coals, made it out to be something that it's not, some weirdo, goofy, crazy thing that no one wants to be a part of. And yet, let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again is. But let the Bible define for us what being born again is. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life, now you're born again. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything, and you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected for the body of Christ. So tonight, I'm going to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, bang, pop my hands together. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. See, Jesus said this. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So when you hear the sound of my hands popping together, when you pop your hand up, I'm a man, I'll see it go up, I'll count it, you could put it right back down. Now you might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that embarrassment tonight, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade, come on. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity in hell away from God? Nah, not you. You're too smart for that. But the devil doesn't think so. That's why he's trying to talk you out of it right now. Listen, you tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God. Ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, or online, across the nation and around the world, God sees right where you're at. If you're here on campus, you can come into the church service and tell an usher right afterwards. If you're online, right after you raise your hand, minimize your browser, and there's a blue button that says Respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and then find the button that says How to Know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. If you need to do this wherever you're at, all across, come on, get ready to get your hands up. We'll do it all together, all at the same time. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. Thank you. There's one. God bless you. Who else tonight? Need to give God. There's two. Got you over there. Thank you. On this side, three, four, five. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else? You guys can put your hands down. Six, got you right there. Thank you. Who else? Six, seven, I got you right there. Thank you. Anybody else real quick? Seven wise people already. If you know you need to do this, just raise it up high for me. If I haven't seen you already, maybe give me a little wave so I can see your hand. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? There's already seven wise people. I didn't embarrass them and I won't embarrass you. Thank you, number eight. Thank you, number nine. Got you right there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else? Number 10. If you're sitting there wondering if you should do this, yeah, come on, you should. Who else tonight? Need to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Come on, number 10, just pop it up high. Thank you, number 10. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? The center section over here. Anybody else on this side that I did not already see? Got 10 wise people already. If that's you, just pop it up high. Anybody else back in the family rooms? Anybody? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 10 wise people. Hallelujah. All right, all 10 of you, if you're number 11, 12, 13, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask everybody in a moment. No one leave during this time. We're trying to allow the Holy Spirit to move. Very rude to the Holy Spirit. So just give me a couple more minutes of your time. We'll let you go, okay? We're all going to stand in a moment, all going to give a clap and a shout. Elijah's going to lead us in a song. As he sings that song, that's your cue. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, get your stuff. Coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight, but we can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand, and if that's you, you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
From the family rooms, if your children raise their hand, you can bring them right now. They're welcome.
Jesus, I belong.
In the foyer, you can come on in.
To you, you're the reason that I live.
They're coming, let's give them a hand
you're
as they come.
You're the reason that I breathe. Jesus, I believe.
Hallelujah.
In you, Jesus, I belong.
Anybody else, if you need to come, you just make your way to the front right now.
To you. You're the reason that I live.
They're still
You're the
coming. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too.
Jesus, I believe.
You can come too. Come on, this is your time. This is your moment. Hey, you guys up front, put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. My goodness, what's God going to do in your future? God is so good. Right over here to my right, your left. See this guy in the blue shirt? This is Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? You already got past this guy, all right? That's about as weird as you're going to encounter tonight. He's cool. He's going to do three things with you. Three, two, no, I'm just kidding, all right? He's going to do three things. Number one, he's going to pray with you, lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Okay. Second thing he's going to do, give you some free information, some free literature, help find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next? Okay. There's a free little booklet that our pastor wrote. Okay. Pastor Jim that you met tonight, he wrote a little booklet called Welcome to Your Destiny, Easy Steps to a Successful Future with God. It's easy reading. Okay. And it's free. We'll let you have it maybe 20, 30 minutes if you read it slow, and you'll find out what to do next in your walk with God. Third thing he's going to do, he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here. Called a spiritual personal trainer, okay? You say, what? It's a friend, all right? Friend in church who will help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to the old ways, but you go on with God in the new ways, okay? And it's easy, it's free, and you need to do it, all right? Now, let me give you guys a promise. Give us 1 year of your life here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. 1 year. sitting consistently under the teaching. If you can make it to Wednesday night, hey, cool. If you can make it to Sunday morning or Saturday morning, maybe you can make it to Sunday night or the Girlfriends Women's Bible Study tomorrow morning. Maybe you can make it young adults on Friday nights. Whatever you can get consistently over the next year, get as much as you can and apply the word to your life. And after that year and for the rest of your life, you'll be saying this. Here's the promise. I'm so blessed. I did not know it could be like this. Am I telling the truth, everyone? Take their word for it, okay? You guys will make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give him a hand as they go.